last talk of this long and very, very, very sharp day. It will be given by Alex Schaefer from Sokolov Institute. And it is called Last Operator Algebra, Configurable Systems and Matrix Devices.
Thank you. First of all, thanks to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to speak here. Second, I would like to say that in 2013, I had 1 hour long discussion with Ernest Borisovich, and this discussion provided me with job for the next 3 years. Some results of this work I will speak on now. So, okay, I will start with a Lux operator algebra. First of all, we have the following geometrical data. A semi-simple algebra G over complex numbers, a set of its simple rules, and element of the Cartan subalgebra belonging to the dual lattice to the lattice. So every root is the value of every root on H is integer. Then we consider a grading given by this element H, the grading of the algebra G, and the corresponding increasing iteration. This is one. How to say, this is one, the first part of data. The second part of data is related to an arbitrary complex on Riemann surface. We consider Riemann surface, a finite genus, with two kinds of marked points. First set of points I will call P points, and the second I will call gamma points for obvious reason due to their just due to their notation. And let's consider meromorphic functions on this Riemann surface, taking values in our Lie algebra G with allowed singularities only at fixed point at marked point, and at P points we allow arbitrary orders. At gamma points we impose some restrictions. We require let's take a gamma point and the position of our function A in the local parameter near this point. Then we require that the coefficients of this expansion belongs to the filtration. I mean, L minus k belongs to G minus k tilde, and so on. And we consider this filtration as infinite, assuming that it stabilizes from the number k. So starting from the number k, this is the whole the algebra. So here we have only conditions on first 2k minus 1 coefficients. Well, it's obvious that the functions, the g-valued functions with these requirements form an infinite dimensional Lie algebra just because this local condition are conserved when we take a commutator. Two coefficients Li and Lj at the powers z to I, z to j. In the commutator, so these two terms in the commutator give a term, with the power I plus j, and the commutator of the corresponding coefficients belongs to g tilde I plus j. So the condition, on coefficients is preserved by commutators. It's a Lie algebra. The elements, the meromorphic functions belonging to this algebra is what I call what is called Lie separator algebra. And actually, the name is due to the fact that it came from the theory of integral systems. There is a kind of fundamental interaction between z gradients on the Lie algebra G, which I used here, and Riemann-Roch theorem on the Riemann surface. This interaction is as follows. Obviously, every function, every element of the Lie separator algebra has poles of the order not bigger than k, where k is the depth of gradient, at the gamma points. So, counting dimensions with Riemann-Roch theorem, we must assume that this divisor k by the sum of gammas is always present. Second, if we take any divisor outside gamma points and count the dimension of the corresponding space by the Riemann-Roch theorem, we will see that the result doesn't fill gamma points. It expresses only their degree of divisor, which is outside points, outside gamma points. The reason for this, fact is the following: if we just take the Riemann, if we count the dimension by Riemann-Roch, we should take dimension of the Lie algebra multiplied by standard expression degree of the divisor minus genus plus one. Well, but the conditions on the coefficients, these local conditions which I imposed on the coefficients, organized in such way that the codimension of those conditions at every point is equal to the dimension of the Lie algebra. So we have two k dimensions, k dimension, where k is the depth of gradient. So at every point, we have k dimension g relations. And we multiply it by the number of points and obtain the full codimension. Subtracting it for Riemann-Roch dimension, we exactly obtain this formula. Uh, It is the application of this fact that like separator algebras possess almost great structure. Let me say that they by no means possess any natural gradient structure, any gradient structure. But we can, for any splitting of p points into two subsets, we can define what is called almost gradient structure. The almost gradient structure is the following. The whole D algebra, like separator algebra, decomposes into the direct sum of finite dimensional subspaces of the constant dimension, and there is such constant R, such positive constant, that if we take the commutator of the subspace number m and number k, it lies inside it turns out to be inside the direct sum of LH, oh sorry, LM, let's read it as M, not as H, where M runs from M plus K to M plus K plus R, and R doesn't depend on M and K. So if R would be equal to zero, we would have usual grading, but we cannot do it, and R is something depending on genus, on the rank of algebra, and so on, and we have only this property which is called almost gradient. For example, if we have how to define the subspace LL. For this purpose, we should for example, let's consider the case when our set of p points consists of only two points, p plus and p minus. So, not many points here, but only one point p plus here and only one point p minus here. Consider for every m, consider the following divisor: minus m p plus m plus genus p minus. Then, by Riemann-Roch and taking account of the relations, we have the following: the dimension of the corresponding subspace is equal to the dimension of our Lie algebra, and we find ourselves in the situation in the situation quite similar to loop algebras, which decompose into the direct sum of subspaces. The direct sum of subspaces of constant dimension equal to dimension of G. In particular, when our Riemann surface is just a sphere with two marked points, 0 and infinity, we obtain a loop algebra by this construction. Now, I would like to give several examples. I should say that I use use for free many something. Many facts found in the seminar of Ernest Borisovich in 60s. In particular, all questions related to Z gradients of semi-simple D algebras were elaborated in detail in the seminar at that time. So, for example, take a root system AM. Consider its gradient related to the simple root A1. then G minus the component G minus 1, homogeneous component G minus 1. So this gradient consists of three components, G minus 1, G0, G1. G minus 1 corresponds to the matrices having only one non-zero line, namely the first line. G1 corresponds to this column, and G0 to this white area of the matrix. We see that if A is a vector column 1, 0, 0, 0, and B is a B transpose is a row 0 star star star, then G minus 1 can be represented just as a matrix product as a matrix product A VT and the zero term of the expansion of the local expansion as a corresponding number points point which I would prefer just don't give this letter pointer. this F0 corresponds belongs to the matrix which consists of this bright gray area and white area. So this block triangular to this block triangular matrix. It can be characterized as submatrix for which the vector A is an eigenvector. So, in general, when we allow our picture to vary up to inner automorphism. The picture changed, but it can be independently characterized. The local expansion of flux of the elements of flux operator algebra can be independently characterized as follows. It has such form, ABT over Z plus A0 plus and so on, where A and B are two arbitrary vectors such that their scalar product is zero and A is an eigenvector for the zero order term. In this form, Lux operators were introduced by Cachevier in 2001 in the context of integrable systems with spectral parameter on the original surface. For the gradient given by simple root A2, the picture is looks like this. We have two by two matrix in the left upper corner. Well, for B PM and the gradient given by alpha 1. The picture is looks like this. This bright gray capital letter T corresponds to the component G minus 1. This dark gray capital T corresponds to G1. And if we consider the gradient corresponding to alpha n, we obtain another picture where not only bright and gray and white submatrices appear, but also convex convex in two directions blocks, which correspond to the subspaces G minus 2, G2. It's easy to see that in the case of the root system CA, CN, we have a dual picture. So, component G minus 2 appear for CN in the gradient corresponding to alpha n, and so on. But it's important. I will explain how it looks in terms in terms of expansions as a Gamma points. It's important for integrable systems. This is the reason why I tell it. So for Bn and the gradient corresponding to alpha 1, to this picture, we have the following expansion in the corresponding point. Excuse me, should be minus here, in order the matrix would be skew symmetric. So, and for symplectically algebra, there appears the term of the order minus 2 corresponding to this to one of these cells, I guess to this one, the term of the order corresponding to this one, the term of the order minus 1 corresponding to this bright gray T, and 0 corresponding to zero corresponding to pi here. Now I pass to another topic, matrix divisors, and I relate everything in the very end. So matrix divisors were introduced by André Weil in 1938, and then considered by Grothendieck, who just made a survey of results due to Weil in the Bourbaki seminar, and more seriously by André Nikolaevich Curie. The data involved is corresponds to Riemann surface, includes Riemann surface sigma, semi-simple D algebra, its faithful G module V, the corresponding Chevalier group over the field of Laroche series. Just about notation, so this double double bracket means denotes Laroche series, the double square bracket denotes Taylor series, and single pair of brackets ratio functions. Well, what is the simplest way to give a holomorphic bundle on a Riemann surface? As for me, the conventional way is the following. We choose a finite cover of the Riemann surface, say takes several points, gamma 1 and so gamma k, and several neighborhoods around them, and just punctured the full Riemann surface, punctured at these points, also as the element of the cover. It's possible in spite it's not.
Okay.
It's all in spite it's not simply connected. Nevertheless, it's possible. Conventional way is to give gluing functions in the punctured circles. But an easier way is to give a null cochain, null Cech cochain with coefficients in our Chevrolet group G of Z. which means that we just give local G-valued functions, G-valued functions on these on these circles, maybe having poles at the centers, and then gluing functions can be represented as a boundary of this cochain, and vice versa. If we have gluing functions, we can always we can factorize it and obtain the corresponding cochain. So two cochains are equivalent. Two cochains A gamma and B gamma are equivalent if there exists a third cochain which is everywhere holomorphic, such that A gamma is a product of C gamma by B gamma. Matrix divisors are defined as cochains, as a quotient of cochains by this equivalence relation. So, what time should I stop? With
3 minutes.
Huh?
Okay, 3 minutes.
3 minutes. Okay, good. So integrable system. We drop out integrable system, okay. Systems, and let's ask what canonical form has matrix divisor. First of all, it's a local problem. We consider it in every such neighborhood, and it reduces to the general theorem on elementary divisors for Chevrolet groups. Actually, listen. So the torus in a Chevrolet group is of the form consists of the elements z to h, where h belongs to the dual weight lattice of the module. Now, and the theorem states that the Chevrolet group G decomposes, looks as such a product, where K is the same group or the ring of Taylor series. A plus is the chamber in the torus. Is the chamber in the torus, okay. So we see that essentially matrix divisor is given by the same kind of data as Lax operator algebra. A finite number of points and a finite number of points and a set of Cartan, integral Cartan elements at these points. Well, just to conclude, I will formulate the classification problem, its solution. I hope to do it in 1.5 minutes. So given the matrix divisor, its section is a local meromorphic. V-valued function, V-valued means that it takes value in the module where our sort of group acts. Psi F is holomorphic in the full domain of definition. The problem is to classify matrix divisors with the same discrete invariance. By discrete invariance, I mean the weight of the module and the set of integral Cartan elements as the points, related to points. To classify matrix divisor with the same discrete invariance and the same shift of sections. The answer is the following. The Bode space of matrix divisors is a homogeneous space. I will not come into details. And what we can find is a tangent space in the unit. It can be described purely, completely in the terms of the root system. We must take this tangent space is the direct sum over all marked points and over all positive or all roots which are positive on the given on the Cartan element at the given point, and it's the linear combination of root vectors with coefficients belonging to the space of polynomials of z of local parameter of degree not bigger than alpha of h gamma. Alpha is root from here, and h gamma is
truncated polynomials.
Huh?
Just truncated polynomials.
And what I have no time to tell, it is, can be also described as a factor of M operators by L operator algebra, which means internal integral system. Sorry. Thank you.
Thank you for listening. Thank you.